From the windswept hills of Morocco to the forests of Malawi and the Kalahari Desert, the story of us, humans, begins in Africa. Over 300,000 years ago, modern humans emerged, and wave after wave left Africa to populate the globe. But today, we're not going to follow those waves. Nope. Today, we stay right here in Africa. In today's video, we ask, what do recent genetic findings tell us about Africa and about humans during the Stone Age? We will glimpse into the early Stone Age, study what was left in the middle Stone Age, and learn what more recent humans of the late Stone Age might have been up to. Let's start by assessing anatomically modern humans and how they rose in Africa. The oldest known Homo sapien fossil was found in Jebel Irhoud in Morocco, dating back to over 300,000 years ago. Now, was this fossil fully modern? Not quite. Think of it as an early version of Homo sapiens. The face and skull were pretty normal, but features such as a heavy brow ridge and larger than normal teeth were more archaic features. Fossils like this show up sporadically across Africa. For example, in South Africa, similar human remains were found to date back to between 300 and 250,000 years ago. These were modern-ish, carried some archaic features. North Africa may have been a key hub for early humans, not just for living, but for gene flow out of Africa. The climate may have been more forgiving, and it formed a natural corridor to the Near East and Europe. Meanwhile, Western Africa remains more mysterious. We know people were there during the Middle to Late Stone Age. Archaeological sites confirm this. However, the humid climate has destroyed most of the fossil evidence. Stone industries have also been found dating back to the Middle and Late Stone Ages in Western Africa. And interestingly, some evidence suggests a wave of technology from Central to Western Africa in terms of stone technology. Though I'm not too knowledgeable about stone industries, I do find it very fascinating. What fossils have been uncovered from the Late Stone Age from Western Africa shows ancient people who looked anatomically modern with some sprinkle of ancient traits. Okay, this part isn't from the Stone Age, but I promise, it nicely ties into how we know more about the Stone Age in Africa. Trust me. Rolling back the time machine to 4,000 years ago, we find the Bantu expansion beginning. The Bantu expansion comprises of agricultural communities spreading from modern-day Nigeria and Cameroon and bringing their Bantu language, tools, farming, and their DNA. This is possibly one of the biggest genetic reshuffles in recent African history, and we don't know too much about it. As Bantu-speaking groups migrated, they assimilated or absorbed many local populations, and the result is a genetic echo of this expansion that still exists in most of sub-Saharan Africa today. But why is this important to understanding the Stone Age? Well, not everyone was swept into the Bantu expansion. Some groups, like the Khoisan and central hunter-gatherers, were significantly unaffected, which means they are a genetic time capsule to understanding what happened pre-Bantu expansion, aka what happened during the Stone Age. In Africa, let's move on to the Khoisan, Africa's earliest divergent group. Modern Khoisan people live mostly in Namibia, South Africa, Botswana, and Angola. Their DNA tells us a wild story. Their group split off from all other humans as early as 260 to 350,000 years ago. That's around the same time Neanderthals were diverging into Europe. Translation, the Khoisan are the most genetically distinct group alive today. An ancient fossil of a Khoisan from around 2,000 years ago shows even back then they had minimal gene flow with outsiders, with only between 9 and 30% admixture from East Africans and Europeans. Meaning, while they were very isolated, they weren't completely cut off. However, this level of isolation is extremely valuable in understanding Africa's deep past, including the Late Stone Age. Another key outgroup are the Central African hunter-gatherers. Much like the Khoisan, they avoided much of the later waves of gene mixing, including the Bantu expansion. Their genetics also hold echoes to early divergence, perhaps not quite as ancient as the Khoisan though. These two groups, the Khoisan and the central hunter-gatherers, act like ancient mirrors, reflecting Africa's genetic structure before it was scrambled by more recent gene flow. Now, here's where things get really juicy. What if some of those archaic features we see in ancient Homo sapiens aren't just archaic traits, but evidence of hybridization? We know South Africa was home to other hominins during the Stone Age, such as Homo heidelbergensis and Homo naledi. So could some of the early fossils we find in places like South Africa, which have archaic features, be evidence of introgression? Some fossils do suggest this, but we don't have ancient DNA from many of these old fossils, and it would be a whole other video to cover this. If you like the sound of that, do check out my South Asian hominin episode, if you haven't. Let's get back to the main question of the video. What can we tell about gene flow during the Stone Age in Africa? Well, rather than a single cradle of humanity, genetic evidence suggests anatomically modern humans may have emerged from multiple regions in Africa, not just one. Also, during the Stone Age, there was ongoing gene flow between North, West, Central, and Southern Africa. But this is not universal. Remember our outgroups, the Khoisan and the Central Hunter-Gatherers. They did not participate much in this continental exchange. The idea of Stone Age gene flow throughout Africa is supported by recent studies which analyzed the ancient genomes from hunter-gatherers from Tanzania, Malawi, Ethiopia, and South Africa. The results clearly suggested there was gene flow between Northeast and Southern Africa during the late Stone Age. DNA analysis of the hunter-gatherers from Malawi and Tanzania respectively revealed they shared Khoisan genetics of up to 2/3 and 1/3. An alternative theory is that the Khoisan may have lived further north at one point. Regardless, it does suggest during the late Stone Age, there was at least some gene flow between South and East Africa, though the specifics of it may be lost to time. And clear evidence of any gene flow in Africa before 10,000 years ago is lacking. Africa just wasn't the origin of humanity, it was the melting pot too. While some groups diverged early and stayed isolated, such as the Khoisan and Central Hunter-Gatherers, others were mixing, migrating, and exchanging genes before the word civilization even existed. The Stone Age was not static in Africa. There was a continent-wide genetic symphony, with some instruments playing solo and others jamming together. Thank you. Please like and subscribe, and join me next time for more science.